Okay, so we've been talking about plasticity models, specifically J2 or von Mises plasticity models. And the reason they were called that, if you remember, is that we had this yield function, and in this case it was only a function of J2, right? Or specifically the square root of 3J2 minus y, where y is a material constant. Okay. So these were called von Mises or J2 plasticity models, but I just want you to be aware that there are other types of plasticity models that are yield criterion that we can use. And so the way we'll say this is there are other yield surfaces. And if you recall, I more or less said that J2 works really well for metals. So when we talk about rocks or concrete or geomaterials in general, we typically wouldn't use a J2 plasticity model, but they're the simplest, and to introduce a lot of the concepts, it's easiest to do that. But so when we move on, another plasticity or yield surface that you might use is called the maximum shear stress. This is also known as the Tresca criterion, obviously named after the guy Tresca who came up with it. And that this is that the yield surface is a function of the maximum shear stress. So in terms of principal stresses and Mohr circle, you remember that the maximum shear stress is going to be 2 times the maximum difference in principal stresses. Okay, so just remember from Mohr circle, if we have 3 unique principal stresses, then we have some Mohr circle like this, where the state of stress is going to be somewhere in this region, right? And this point right here is going to be 2 times the maximum shear stress, okay? And so if this is sigma 1 and this is sigma 3, then this criterion would be the maximum, and then your yield surface would be a function of that, right? And so what that looks, so if you remember in the pi plane, where we're looking down the hydrostat, down the sigma 1 equals sigma 2 equals sigma 3 line, you remember J2 was a circle. And so what this represents, it actually overlaps with the J2 surface in a few locations. But is otherwise has this shape. Okay. Now it's still infinite. Okay. So that was looking down the axis, but let me see if I can draw it in 3 dimensions, right? So here's the line sigma 1 equals sigma 2 equals sigma 3. So the yield surface is going to have some kind of shape like this. Okay. So there's no pressure dependence, in other words. It's infinite along, you know, it's the same shape along the line in the positive direction and along the line in the negative direction in both ways. Okay? So you might ask, you know, is there a way that we can write this in terms of the invariance? And there is. It's kind of a complicated expression, but it's equal to 4... J2 cubed minus 27 J3 squared minus 9 J squared squared plus y squared minus 6j2y to the fourth minus y to the sixth, and that's equal to 0. So you do notice that j3 appears here, and what's j3? If you remember, j3 is the determinant of sigma, which is also the product of the eigenvalues of the product of the principal stresses. So, for the case of uniaxial, for the case of a uniaxial stress test, we have a stress tensor that looks like this, 2/3 y 0 0 0 minus 1/3 y 0 0 0 minus 1/3 y. Okay, and the convention I'm using here is that positive stresses are in tension. Okay, so if we compute, and now the principal stresses are just along the diagonal, so it's just the product of those diagonal terms. So J3 here is 2/27 y cubed, okay? But if this was the negative, or say this was a state of uniaxial compression stress. So in other words, this would be negative, this would be positive, this would be positive. If we were then to compute J3, we'd have minus 2/27 y cubed. So this is in tension. Uniaxial stress in tension, this is uniaxial stress in compression. Okay, and so what you see here is that you have a negative sign, and so a lot of times the J3, what the third invariant of the deviatoric stress is, this is the deviatoric stress, so Sij. So what the third invariant of the deviatoric stress is, or can be used for, is to sometimes distinguish between compressive and tensile states. And so you might have a yield surface, and in this case it's not happening, but you might have a yield surface where your dependence on J3 could be different whether it's in tension or compression. And this is quite useful for building complex models in, say, a rock or a concrete, where obviously they're typically stronger or fail easier in tension as compared to compression. Okay, so that's the Tresca criterion.